When we look into Sharada Devi's personality, usually we find that there are three aspects which come out very prominently. And these three aspects are, one is Sharada Devi as the mother. The second is she as the bestower of spiritual knowledge and wisdom. And the third one is she as the deity, the Devi. So today we shall be focusing on Sri Sharada Devi as the bestower of spiritual knowledge and wisdom. This is one of her many aspects of her personality. But before we go ahead into the subject, we should remember one thing, that we make these distinctions in her personality just because our buddhi is incapable to fathom the depths of this phenomenon called Sharada Devi. Our human buddhi, we all are ordinary human beings, and we cannot plumb the depths of this phenomenon called this Sharada Devi. She is a phenomenon. What we see on the surface and what she actually is behind that, the form that comes before our eyes and what lies behind that, is something which an ordinary human being or the ordinary human mind won't be in a position to fully understand. So we have to admit our buddhi's deficiency, incapability to fully understand who she is. And that is the reason why we make these distinctions and then try to understand as much as possible, trying to go close to this phenomenon through these divisions. Sharada Devi as mother, as one who bestows spiritual knowledge, and one who is the deity, who is the Devi. Truly speaking, behind these three aspects which we have referred to now, the reality is that she is an indivisible whole. To use a Sanskrit term, she is Akhanda Mahashakti. She is Akhanda. The word Akhanda is very significant. There is no Khanda in that. There is no division. There is no part in it. She is indivisible whole. To go more deeper, we have to say that she is the root of this creation. She is the Saguna Brahman come in this particular form. So, it is that indivisible, that ultimate reality which has come in the form of this human woman. And in and through this form, that indivisible reality is playing in so many ways, in which prominently we see these three profiles: Sharada Devi as mother, Sharada Devi as one who bestows spiritual knowledge, and Sharada Devi as the deity, the Devi. The Devi with all Aishwarya and glory. In 1872, let us go back into the history. We all know it was July, the day of Falaharini Kali Puja. On that day, Sri Ramakrishna wished to worship the Divine Mother as Tripura Sundari Shodashi. We all know this. This is a very important event in Sri Ramakrishna's life. So there we find that Sri Ramakrishna makes all the preparation for worshipping Jagadamba as Tripura Sundara Shodashi. Usually whenever this kind of a worship is done, the worshipper usually takes the help of a symbol, a pratik. We need a symbol, we need a pratik, we need a pratima. We all do puja in our houses, but we have symbols, is it not? We have pratima, a murti. Or it may be a photograph, or even the puja is done even in the ghata. There's so many ways of doing it. But Sri Ramakrishna didn't use any of these pratikas. On that day, when all the preparations were done, he spread one asan there in front of him and he made Sri Sharada Devi sit on that asan and making her the symbol, he worshipped that Jagadamba as Tripura Sundari Shodashi. Now, at the end of this worship, what happened? We all know that. The worshipper and the worshipped became one. Not only that, in and through this worship, Sri Ramakrishna awakened in Sri Sharada Devi the awareness that she was none other than Jagadamba herself. The symbol and the symbolized became one. In Sharada Devi, this awareness was awakened that she was a special manifestation of that Jagadamba, that infinite Akhanda Mahashakti. In a way, we can say that we all are the manifestations of that Jagadamba only, but we are all ordinary manifestations. But in Sri Sharada Devi, we find it is Jagadamba who herself, that infinite Mahashakti, has come down in a special form for a special mission, for a special role to be played in human society. So this awareness was awakened in Sharada Devi in and through that Shodashi worship. So from that time onwards, we see a very important aspect of Sharada Devi's personality becomes awakened and fully manifested. Which aspect was not fully manifested before this event? That was in 1872. So then we find that Sri Ramakrishna, whenever he used to talk about Sharada Devi, he used to say that she is Sharada, she is Saraswati, she has come to give knowledge. This was a very common statement which Sri Ramakrishna used to always make. It is very interesting that when Mother was asked about her special role, Mother used to say that she, Thakur has left me behind to show to the world the idol of the motherhood of God. Now, which one is right? Sri Sharada Devi is saying that Thakur has left me behind to show to the world the ideal of the motherhood of God. Whereas Sri Ramakrishna says that she is Saraswati, she has come to give knowledge. So apparently speaking, it seems as if Ma is saying one thing and Thakur is saying something else. But it is not like that. Both of them are saying the same thing. Why is it like that? As I told in the beginning, these divisions are made by us. Truly speaking, she is an indivisible whole playing both these roles. And both these roles cannot be isolated and compartmentalized. They actually blend with each other in one whole entity. For example, if you look at Sharada Devi as mother, so what would the mother do to her children? She would always give the best things to her children. And the best thing which the mother can give to her children is spiritual knowledge and wisdom. So in the role of the mother, this role of bestowing spiritual knowledge is inseparably present. And if you look into Sharada Devi as the bestower of spiritual knowledge, in that you will find her role as mother fully present. Because behind this action of giving knowledge to the people, It is the mother heart which is standing behind with great compassion, and with that compassion Sharada Devi bestows this knowledge to everybody. So these two statements, that she is the giver of knowledge, which Thakur states, and the statement of Sharada Devi as that she says that Thakur has left me behind to show to the world the ideal of the motherhood of God, they are not two different things. Because in motherhood, the role of bestowing spiritual knowledge is present. And when we look at her as bestowing spiritual knowledge, behind that is the great mother heart. So in this way, if you just see all these different profiles of Sharada Devi, they blend into one whole. Behind her mother's profile, and behind her profile as the bestower of spiritual knowledge, there is the infinite deity, the Devi. The Jagadamba is standing there. So it is that Jagadamba which is playing these two different, so-called different roles, which are not different. They all blend into becoming in one indivisible whole. Now, her name is Sarada, a beautiful name. It is very interesting. There is a very certain interesting things about her name also. Many of you may be knowing that her parents actually gave her the name Thakur Mani. According to the Rashi, the naming which is done according to the disposition of the stars in India, her actual name was Thakur Mani. In India, we all know that we have a practice of giving two names. One is the formal name and the other is the informal name, which is used in our day-to-day life. This happens with everybody. So, Sri Sharada Devi's parents gave her the name Thakur Mani, which was the real formal name according to the disposition of the stars. But they gave the so-called household name called Kshemankari. This many of you may not be knowing. Kshemankari. Kshemankari means one who brings well-being to all. But what happened at that time, Shama Sundari Devi's sister was present there, and she had lost her daughter whose name was Sarada. So it was she who suggested and told Shama Sundari Devi that let this baby be named Sarada in memory of my daughter who has passed away, so that her memory remains alive. That is how this name Sarada came to this little baby who was born in 1853. Whatever it is, but this name has become a worldwide well-known name now today for this personality, and we can see that there could not have been a better name than Sarada for this person. Because what is the meaning of Sarada? Sarada in Sanskrit means one who gives. The Sar in Sanskrit, Da means to give, and Sar means the essence. So one who gives or imparts the essence of spiritual knowledge, that person is Sarada. See, we have all kinds of empirical knowledge in the world. We have the sensory knowledge. And the essence of all this empirical and sensory knowledge is the spiritual knowledge. Upanishad says, Brahma Vidya is Sarva Vidya Pratishtha. So, the person who gives this core spiritual knowledge, that person is Sarada. So this name is a very interesting name, and we can say that in this one term, Sarada, the entire life story and the personality of Sarada Devi is embedded. It's completely packed in that one word. Why? If you just look into Sarada Devi's life, what else has she done apart from imparting spiritual wisdom to whoever has come close to her? whoever came close to Sarada Devi, Sarada Devi's only one main function which we see in this person's life is awakening the spiritual consciousness of everyone. So, the entire life story of this personality can be summed up in this one word called Sarada. It's a beautiful thing. Now, when we talk about imparting spiritual wisdom to others, we all know that that is the work of the Guru. Usually, it is the Guru who gives spiritual wisdom to others. And the place of Guru is indispensable in spiritual life. Spiritual knowledge cannot come unless a Guru comes into our life. Spiritual knowledge can never come merely by reading books. Spiritual knowledge is imparted by an enlightened Guru to the spiritual seeker. It is a transmission of spiritual consciousness from one person to the other. It cannot come by merely reading books. It doesn't happen that way. So that's why in our scriptures, Guru is equal, considered to be equal to be God, equal to God, because it is from Guru this God's knowledge comes to the disciple. What is Guru's role? Sri Shankaracharya says, Yasmat Bandha Vimokshanam. Guru is that person who brings about Bandha Vimokshanam. He puts an end to our bondage by giving us liberation. Acharyavan Purusho Veda. One who has Acharya, a Guru, that person will attain spiritual illumination. And what is the role of the Guru? The famous definition we have. Agyana Timiranthasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshuru Meelitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. This is a famous definition. Guru is a person who removes the darkness from the disciple's heart by bringing spiritual light there. That is the main function of the Guru. Now, when we talk about Guru and Guru's place is indispensable in spiritual life, we all know that. Then we can say in a very general manner that there are two kinds of Gurus. One is the ordinary Guru. Usually we come across the ordinary Gurus, but by saying ordinary Guru, let us not think that is something small. That itself is very great and very big and very important. But different from this so-called ordinary Gurus, we have the avatars. The way of imparting spiritual knowledge by the ordinary Gurus, that is a sadharana prakriya, an ordinary methodology. But the way of imparting spiritual knowledge by a Guru who is actually an avatara, that prakriya is asadharana prakriya. That is not sadharana prakriya. So that happens once in several centuries. When an avatara comes and when that avatara plays the role of a Guru, that avatara's method of imparting knowledge is something totally out of the ordinary run. It's asadharana prakriya. So this asadharana way of imparting spiritual knowledge, we can see throughout in Sarada Devi's life. I will give some instances in this regard. See, when we talk about Guru imparting spiritual knowledge, one very important thing which Sarada Devi also says, and that is there in our parampara also, she says that when the Guru imparts spiritual knowledge to the disciple, there is a mutual transmission of energy. The Guru's spiritual energy goes into the disciple and the disciple's sins get into the body of the Guru. This happens. The Guru has to take the burden of the sins of the disciple and suffer. This the guru does voluntarily. Now, this happens with so-called the ordinary gurus, but this happens in a very big way in the avataras. The avataras come down to free us from the burden of the sins under the weight of which we are actually suffering and lamenting. I'll give some instances in this regard. When devotees used to come to Sarada Devi, we all know that, whether it is Jairambadi or whether it is Mayarwadi, hundreds and hundreds of people would come and they would be lining up outside her house and they would be waiting to have her darshan, to touch her feet, to get initiation, to get spiritual guidance and help. And one day it was seen that Sharda Devi, there are people making pranams to her, they are touching her feet and she is initiating some and everything is going on. So one day she was seen to be again and again washing her feet with Ganga water. So Yogin Ma, who was standing close by, she asked Sarada Devi, "Why Ma, why are you again and again washing your feet? What has happened?" So she said, "My child, what to do? These people, they come and they, some people who touch my feet, I feel very good. But many of them, when they touch my feet, my whole body begins to burn. And I don't get any respite unless I wash my feet with Gangajal." Actually, what is happening is, she is taking the sins of these disciples or these devotees into herself and she suffers. At some places she says, she knows that she is continuously drinking this poison and yet she doesn't turn away anyone who comes at her door. An incident which comes to my mind is, there was a woman in Calcutta who had deviated from the path of righteousness and she was leading a wrong kind of a life and she was involved in many so-called immoral things which a person should not do. And after having led that kind of a life for a long time, she understands that she has been committing a grave sin and she begins to repent. And out of repentance, one day she comes to Mayarwadi and she stands at the gate. You all have gone to Mayarwadi. She stands there outside on the road and she calls from there, "Oh Ma, I want to have your darshan, but I am not pure enough to step into the holy premises of this building. So I cannot come inside, but please grant me your darshan." Hearing this, Ma comes down and straight away, Ma knows that this lady has been leading a very immoral life and she is under the burden of a huge heap of sins. In spite of that, Mother goes and puts her hand on her shoulders and very affectionately she says, "My child, come in, come in, come with me. I will give you diksha." That lady didn't even ask for diksha, but Mother says, "I will give you diksha, come." And saying so, she takes that lady inside the room and imparts her mantra. Now you see, while giving this mantra, she is taking all the sins of that lady on herself and freeing her from the burden of the sins, so that in her the spiritual knowledge will be awakened. This is Jnana Dayani Sarada. We should remember one thing. This dawn of spiritual knowledge will not happen as long as our heart is not freed from all impurities and sins. As long as there are sins in our heart, this dawn of spiritual knowledge is impossible. So when we talk about Sarada Devi as one who bestows spiritual knowledge, connected to that is her role as Papanashini or Patito Dharini. It is by destroying the purpose of the Shishya, she makes the way clear for the dawn of spiritual knowledge in the heart of the devotees. So, along with the role of Gyanadayini, there is also the role of Papanashini Sharada Devi. Throughout the life, we can see those who have read Sharada Devi's life very meticulously, she has been continuously taking the sins of the devotees and her disciples on herself, fully knowing well that for that her body will suffer. Throughout the life, she suffered from various ailments only by taking the sins of the disciples and devotees on herself, so that their path to spiritual knowledge and wisdom becomes clear. This is the dual role of one who is bestowing knowledge by removing all the impurities from the hearts of the devotees and the disciples. Once what happened? Three devotees, they went to Raja Maharaj for initiation. Raja Maharaj could see their condition and he didn't dare to give initiation. And what he did was, he wrote a letter to Sri Sarada Devi and asked those three devotees to go to Jairanbati for initiation with the letter, a letter of introduction from Raja Maharaj. Now these three devotees, they landed up in Jairanbati with the letter of introduction. And when mother read that letter and mother was seeing them, mother instantly refused to initiate them. Mother said, "I can't initiate." And they went out of the room. And when they went out of the room, mother was murmuring. She was talking to herself and she was saying that children who stay abroad, they send good things for their mother. Just look at Rakhal. Just look at Raja Maharaj. Look at my Raja. What is he sending? He is sending such people to me. Such people means mother could see that they are fully sinful people, steeped in all kinds of wrong things. And Raja Maharaj is sending such people to mother for initiation. So when these three devotees, they went outside, after some time, they were extremely pained that mother has refused to initiate them. So they once again came back. Once again, they pleaded. Again, Ma said, "No, I won't." Again, they went out. Again, they came back with tears in their eyes. Now, you see, the one who is bestowing the spiritual knowledge, she is also the mother. She has got the mother's heart. Requested for initiation, mother succumbed to that request and she said, "Okay, I will initiate you." And she initiated. And later on, after a few days, somebody went to Belur Math and narrated this whole incident to Raja Maharaj. Raja Maharaj was sitting in that baranda facing the Ganga. Raja Maharaj was sitting, Raja Maharaj, Mahapurush Maharaj, Baburam Maharaj and Sharad Maharaj. They were all sitting on the bench facing the Ganga. And one person came and narrated the whole incident. Hearing that, Raja Maharaj became stunned. He became silent. He became speechless. There was nothing for him to utter. And Baburam Maharaj was standing close to him. Baburam Maharaj, with folded hands, he said, "Kripa, Kripa, Kripa. It's all compassion. Mercy, mercy. Mother's infinite mercy. It is by her mercy that we are all protected." Baburam Maharaj was saying, "It is by the mother's mercy that we are all protected. The poison today which mother has taken on herself, if even a small portion of that poison, if we had to take, we would have burned to ashes." This is what Baba Maharaj uttered. The poison which mother had taken today, if we had to take even a small portion of that poison, we would have been burned to ashes. They were all stunned. Now, what I want to emphasize is this role of imparting spiritual knowledge is connected to the role of removing the impurities from the disciples' hearts. These are inseparable two things happening in a guru's life. The guru is imparting knowledge, at the same time, guru is removing the burden of the sins and impurities from the disciples' heart. This is happening. And this happened in a very big way in Sharada Devi's personality. We can see that. Now, people used to see Sharada Devi constantly doing japam. We all know that she would be doing japam. Outwardly, she would be involved in all her household activities. But inwardly, always the japam would go on. It is said that she used to do at least 1 lakh japam every day. We can't even imagine that. So, even in the middle of the night, she used to sleep very little sleep, always doing japam. So, one day in the middle of the night, one of her companions, she asked Sharada Devi, "Mother, you are not sleeping. You are doing japam even at this time. Please take rest. Sleep for some time. Take some sleep. Whole day you have been working." So she says, "What to do, my child? All these people, they come to me. They come to me and request for initiation and diksha. They take the mantra and go away. And after going away, they do nothing. Some of them do a little bit of japam and they leave it away. Many of them, they don't even repeat 108 times, which a guru has said, at least repeat the japam, at least do the japam 108 times. Even that they don't do. What to do? As they are not doing, I am doing that for them." Just imagine, is there anything for her to gain for doing japam? Is she doing japam for herself? She was continuously repeating the japam for all her disciples, for all her shishyas. Many of them, they were not even doing japam. So, and what happens when the japam is done? In and through japam, all the impurities of the heart is cleaned. So she was doing it for the disciples. But this is how she used to bestow knowledge directly and indirectly. She had taken the burden of removing all the obstacles from the path of the shishyas and disciples and help them move towards the attainment of spiritual knowledge. Now, we all know that, you know, Sri Ramakrishna, in his gospel, he states in one place that if the devotee takes one step towards God, God comes down 9 steps to help the devotee. Very important and remarkable statement. If the devotee takes one step towards Bhagavan, Bhagavan comes 9 steps down to help the bhakta. This is the principle. Once what happened? One devotee from Barishal, he was very eager to meet the mother. And from a great distance and with great difficulty, he reaches Mayurwadi, Bagh Bazar. At that time, mother was suffering from physical ailments, and Sharad Maharaj and all the attendants, they had decided that they will not allow anybody have the darshan of mother. Mother should not be disturbed for some days. So they had stopped all the darshan. So at that time, this devotee had come. The devotee had taken one big step to come and have the blessings of mother. And when he reached Mayurwadi, Sharad Maharaj and all the attendants said, "No, you can't have darshan." And there was a kind of a discussion and little loud talking was going on. They were not allowing him to go up and have darshan. So hearing this commotion, mother came. And she saw from up what was happening. And she said from there, "You see, what else have we come here for? we came here, we means she is referring to herself and also Thakur also in that. She says that, what is the purpose for which we have come down here? We have come for this very work. So let him come. I will initiate him. When all the attendants were saying, no, they can't have, this man cannot have the darshan of mother. Mother came out and said, no, let him come inside. I will initiate him. Even when she was suffering from different ailments, she was not at all in a good state of health. Even in that state, she initiated that person. When the bhakta takes one step, Bhagavan comes down 9 steps to help that bhakta move towards spiritual illumination. This is just one instance. We can find any number of instances like that in Sharada Devi's life. One person, he had taken initiation from Sharada Devi. And even after doing japam for some time, he was not finding peace of mind. So he was becoming frustrated. And slowly he stopped doing japam also. In that state, one day, he comes to Sharada Devi and tells Sharada Devi, oh Ba, I am doing japam, but I am not getting peace of mind. So mother says, my child, you do it. Do it for some more time. Practice it. Abhyas. Abhyas is the way. Don't give it up. Everything will happen at the right moment. Have patience. Do it. But again that man said, no Ma, I have been doing it for some time, but nothing is happening. He was impatient. And in that impatient and frustrated state of mind, he said that, Ma, I know nowadays I am not doing japa. I know if the disciple doesn't repeat the mantra, it will cause harm to the guru. The disciple is saying like that. So he says, in that case, mother, you take back the mantra. You take back my rosary. So mother becomes very, very grave. Tears begins to roll down her cheeks. Mother says, you see, mother tells her companions, you see what this boy is saying. I don't get sleep thinking about my children. Day and night I think about my children. Day and night I repeat mantra for them. Thakur has taken all the responsibility of my children. And this boy says that you take away the mantra back. See what is he saying? Okay, from today you don't have to do japa. Mother tells that man that from today you don't have to do japa. And she turned away. Now this man comes to the senses. He understands that he has done something wrong. He has spoken something wrongly. He should not have spoken in this way. Immediately he repents. And immediately he tells mother, oh mother, what have I said? I told that you take back the mantra. Now what will happen to me? Is it that I will go to hell and suffer hellfire? Will that happen to me? At that time mother says, now look at mother's statement. Mother says, hellfire, you are my child and you will suffer from hellfire. Even the destiny has got no power to send my children to the hell. This is the great ashwasan or the abhayadan, we can say, the giving of fearlessness coming from Sri Sharada Devi. She says that even the destiny has got no power to send my children and my disciples to hell. What do you think? You have come to me. You have taken refuge from me. You have got initiation from me. Taking initiation from me means you are liberated. Ma says, those who take initiation from me, they are already redeemed. It is only a matter of time. The disciples don't understand this. And then she says, Thakur is there. Thakur, I have offered you at the feet of Thakur. And everything will happen at the right time. This is avatara's prakriya of jnana dana, which is asadharana prakriya, which usually doesn't happen, which only avataras can do. It is very interesting to say that, see this. So mother used to always give this consolation to her disciples and all the devotees. Always she used to say, why fear, my child? Always remember I am there and Thakur is there. And always know that at the end of your life, Thakur has to come to take you to his abode. And she used to very interestingly, she would say, what else has this Thakur come for? Has he come only to have rasagullas? She would tell this to her, and once she has told this to her disciple, Thakur didn't come to just have rasagullas. He has come and he has taken the burden of all his devotees and disciples. Those who are repeating this mantra, Thakur's mantra, she says in one place, do you think this mantra is just empty word? She asked this question, very, very important question. She says, do you think this mantra is an empty word? It is packed with infinite potency. Only we don't have the patience to use this mantra properly. If there is proper love and devotion for God, and with that devotion, if anybody repeats this mantra, which has come down from Thakur himself, everything has to happen at the right moment and at the right time. Spiritual knowledge is going to come. It is only a matter of time. Mother is to beautifully say, those who have taken initiation from me, they are already liberated. But if you want to enjoy the bliss of Jivan Mukti, if you want to enjoy the bliss of Bhakti and Bhava and Prema, then you have to do Japa. Otherwise, you will be leading a life full of suffering and misery, but you will be liberated at the end. Your liberation is guaranteed. But if you want to lead a life immersed in the bliss of Adhyatmik Jnana, then you have to do Japa. So this is a great statement coming from, this is only an avatar can say like that. You are already liberated. The mantra which you have got. Now if you want to enjoy the bliss of spiritual life, you have to do Japa. Now another aspect of Sharada Devi's prakriya of bestowing spiritual knowledge, which is also very interesting. You see, when avatara plays the role of a guru, avatara has got the capacity to straight away make the disciple have the darshan of the ishta. This ordinary gurus cannot do. That's why I made a distinction in the beginning of my talk that ordinary gurus, yes, that is also very great and very rare. But when avatara comes as a guru, that avatara's prakriya is asadharana prakriya. It is not sadharana prakriya. Sarada Devi, she used to make her disciples who came for initiation, she used to make them straight away have the darshan of the ishta. This is a capacity exclusively seen only in avataras and avataras alone. There was a devotee called Surendra Sarkar. The Surendra Sarkar had come to mother for initiation, and just a day before the initiation, the night before the initiation, he spent the whole night in a cremation ground. I think this happened in Jairambati, of course. And in that cremation ground, he was praying and he was doing all kinds of spiritual disciplines. He was preparing himself for the next day's diksha. But one thought which was troubling him was that he was thinking that what mantra will mother give me? That was the one thought which was troubling him. Because whole life he had been worshipping a certain deity. So there was a doubt in his mind whether mother will impart the mantra of that deity or some other deity. So this was the one thing, one thought which was troubling him. So next day when he went to mother for initiation in the early hours, mother asked him to sit on the asana. And when the person sat, mother closed her eyes for some time and then she imparted the mantra. And then she pointed out with her fingers, you see, you look there, this is your Ishta. The moment mother showed him the Ishta, that disciple, Surendra Sarkar, saw a radiant form of his chosen deity, the radiant form of his Ishta Dev. And he was dumbfounded. And most interestingly, then mother asks him, is this not the God whom you have been worshipping throughout your life? So are you happy now? Because that was the thought which was troubling him throughout the night. What mantra will mother give him? So the mother gave him exactly that very mantra, that the mantra of that deity, that devata, which this person was worshipping for a long time. So that person sat there. He was lost and intoxicated in a spiritual bliss. And then Sharad Maharaj later on came and sprinkled some water on his face and then made him go from that place. Next day, that person went to Belurbat. It is very interesting to tell Raja Maharaj that he has got initiation from Sarada Devi Ma. And when he made pranam to Rakhal Maharaj, saying that I have been initiated by Ma, Baburam Maharaj was standing there. Baburam Maharaj, he loudly told, look, Rakhal, look, mother has made this person cross the ocean of the samsara. Mother has made this person cross the ocean of the samsara. Mother has made this person cross the ocean of samsara. That is mother's initiation. Mother's initiation means crossing the ocean of the samsara is guaranteed. She is the Jnanadayini. She is the Mukti Pradayini. She is the Papanashini, Ma Sarada. An amazing thing which you find. There was a lady called Kusum Kumari. I'm not sure whether she was the disciple of mother, whatever it is. But one day, mother was doing japam there. And Kusum Kumari was sitting little behind mother, and Kusum Kumari was also doing japa. Both of them were counting their beads. Mother was sitting ahead and Kusum Kumari was sitting behind. And as she was immersed in doing japa, suddenly when she opened her eyes, in the place of mother, she saw radiance, an effulgence, and mother in between that effulgence. And mother was sitting stark naked, and from her body millions and millions of jivas were being born. And as soon as these jivas were being born, mother was eating them. So when she saw this kind of a terrifying kind of a darshan she had, she closed her eyes. Again she opened her eyes, she found mother sitting there, just as before, she is doing her japa. Afterwards, Kusum Kumari told this to mother and, okay, mother, I had this kind of a darshan, I saw you, you were sitting naked and from you, millions and millions of jivas are born and you are eating them back. What is this, mother? So mother said, you see, the darshan which you had, this is the darshan of Mahamaya Prakriti. It is this Prakriti, Mahamaya, which is giving birth to this entire Srishti, and It is that Mahamaya which takes this entire Srishti back into its own self. So, Mother can make such darshans possible for her devotees and Shishyas because she herself is Mahamaya. Because she herself is Jagadamba. She is Jagadamba, she is a Jnanadayini, she is a Papanashini all together. That is the speciality of her personality. There was another devotee called Umesh Datta. Now this devotee, he went to Mother and he requested, Ma, I want to have the experience of spiritual bliss, Brahmananda. So Mother said, you see, all these things will happen at the right time. So patiently you do your spiritual practices, it will happen at the right time. Go. But Umesh was not ready to accept this. He said, no, Ma, you have to give me this experience now itself. You have to give me this experience now itself. He is asking Mother to give. Mother is Sarada, one who gives. Umesh is asking Mother, you please give me this experience now. So finally, Mother had to relent. Okay. So what did Mother do? Mother, she closed her eyes and she kept her hand on his head and she did japam for some time and she went away. Umesh was sitting there and within a few moments, he was floating in anandam, anandam, anandam. An unspeakable anandam, as if he's intoxicated. And he was seeing Mother everywhere. This entire creation pervaded by Mother, 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 Divine Mother. This was the experience. And after some time, again he came back to the noble state of mind. So what I want to say is that this is Sarada. The bestower of knowledge, by her mere wish, she can make the disciple, make the devotee have spiritual experiences if she wishes. She is Sarada, she is Saraswati, she has come to give knowledge to the entire world, Thakur says. Now, see, we have been talking about those people who have got a huge heap of sins in them. But what about the pure souls? That is also a very interesting part. You know, when these pure souls, those hearts, those whose hearts are very pure, when they come close to their guru, just by being in the proximity of the guru, they may get spiritually illumined. By the mere touch of the guru, they may get spiritually illumined. By hearing some upadesha from the guru, they may get spiritually illumined. So this we can see happening in the lives of those disciples who are very pure by their very birth. For example, let us take the example of Vijnanandaji Maharaj, who is a direct disciple, who is a disciple of Sri Ramakrishna. When Vijnanandaji first visited Sri Sharada Devi, that was her first visit, his first visit. So he was sitting downstairs and Ma was upstairs. He has not seen Ma till now. He was waiting downstairs. Even by just coming into the proximity of this personality, Vijnan Maharaj says, the lotus of my heart bloomed fully. That was Vijnan Maharaj's experience. Just by even coming in proximity of this personality called Sarada Devi, he has not even seen her now. He is just somewhere close to her. Just by that much, this person's, the lotus of his heart was fully bloomed. So this is how these great avatars, especially in case of Sharada Devi, we can see when such pure souls comes, they are directly impacted by the spiritual source which Sharada Devi is. One more very interesting incident which comes to my mind in this respect, which I am tempted to speak about, which I have spoken in other occasions also. You might have heard it perhaps, but it is very interesting to relate that story here. You know, usually we all have this, many people have this notion that, see, in Sri Ramakrishna's life, we see the dazzle of spirituality. In mother's life, we don't see anything. Outwardly, nothing is seen. She is just a very ordinary woman. From morning till night, she is busy doing all her household activities. That's all. We don't see samadhis and bhavas and all these things, which usually we find in Sri Ramakrishna's life, fully packed. Sri Ramakrishna's life, we find every now and then he is in samadhi, he is in bhava, he is in different states of spiritual experiences, he is dancing in ecstasy and whatnot. This is continuously happening in Sri Ramakrishna's life. What do we find in mother's life? Nothing. So one new brahmachari who had joined the Ramakrishna order, so he had this doubt in the mind that who is this Sharada Devi? In Sri Ramakrishna's life, we see so much of spiritual splendor, spiritual power, all manifested, nothing hidden. In Sharada Devi's life, nothing manifested, everything hidden. Everything hidden by her own Maya, actually. Only a few people could understand her. So, this newly joined brahmachari, he was the attendant of Swami Shantanandaji Maharaj. You all know Shantanandaji Maharaj is a very revered Swami of our Ramakrishna order. And he was also the disciple of Ma. So he went to Shantanandaji Maharaj and told him that, Maharaj, in Sri Ramakrishna's life we see so much of spiritual splendor, Aishwarya, his bhavas, his samadhis and his spiritual experiences. But we don't find anything like that in mother's life. No samadhi, no bhava, nothing. So I can't fully appreciate who this Sharada Devi is, why she is being adored so much. So in this way, his brahmachari was putting forth his viewpoint, and Shantanandaji Maharaj was silently listening to this boy's narration, and he was also getting slightly enraged, angry. After some time, when the brahmachari stopped, Shantanandaji Maharaj literally, he burst upon this brahmachari. He said, "You fool, you are such a small-minded person. Your buddhi is so small, you have no right understanding. Do you think mother is an ordinary sadhika who will practice spiritual disciplines throughout her life, and towards the end of all those disciplines, she will be attaining samadhi for some time and she will be considering herself to be a blessed soul? Do you think Sharada Devi is of that kind?" Shantanandaji Maharaj then said, "You see, the samadhi which you are seeing in Sri Ramakrishna's life, the different bhavas and different spiritual states of mind which you are seeing in Sri Ramakrishna's life, you know from where it is coming? It is coming by the grace of Sharada Devi. Sharada Devi is the giver of samadhi. She is not the aspirer of samadhi. I may be an aspirer of samadhi. You all may be an aspirer of samadhi. She is the one who gives samadhi. She is the one who makes this samadhi possible even in Sri Ramakrishna." So that is this phenomenon called Sharada Devi. Jnanadayini, Papanashini, Patitodharini, Sharada Devi. whatever terms we may use, we can use any number of terms. Terms will fall short to understand this phenomenon because she is beyond all terms. Sri Shankaracharya very beautifully states one thing in his Annapurna Stotra. While describing the Divine Mother, Shankaracharya says, who is Divine Mother? She is Moksha Dwara Kapata Patanakari. That is the statement there. Divine Mother is Moksha Dwara Kapata Patanakari. What does it mean? Moksha Dwara, the door to moksha. Divine Mother is the one who holds the key to the door which opens towards moksha. Sarada Devi is that. The key to moksha, the key to knowledge, the key to samadhi, everything is in the hands of that phenomenon which we today are referring to as Sarada Devi. She is Sarada, she is Saraswati, she has come to impart knowledge. Throughout her life, that was the one main work which she has been doing. With this, I end my this discourse, and I pray to Mother that may she remove all the obstacles from our hearts and make us eligible to have that ultimate spiritual knowledge. May she bless all of us. Thank you.